and at least be able to speak without coughing so much. So I am very sorry. I hope this video finds you well, and I hope the content is still relevant for your situation so that we can, you know, progress through January 2020 with a little bit more guidance. Right off the bat, so I've done all the other signs except you guys, Scorpio and Sagittarius. Out of the 10 cards on the deck, I have 6 cards that are major arcana cards. And this is a big deal, okay? This is a huge deal because I feel like this is going to be a very pivotal month for you guys. I felt that way with the Aquarius reading and then also with the Gemini reading. So I feel like it's an air sign energy, or there's something coming through, some planetary aspects coming through that will be affecting the air signs in a very positive way, I feel, especially for this reading. And let me just say that out of the 10 cards, I have 2 cards that are about choices and options, okay? So I have here the Lover's card. The depiction is very different here, but this is the Major Arcana, number 6, which is the Lover's card, choices and trust, okay? So choices, excuse me, and the 7 of Cups, choices and options, mulling over, you know, all the things that could be, all the things that we want to come in, to manifest and to come into being for us. So both of these are about choices and options. And then I also have an energy here of temptation, okay? We have here the shadow card. And the shadow card is the devil card in the traditional Rider-Waite deck. This is about things that we have a really strong affinity to, a pull towards, that we feel might not be completely good for us, but nevertheless, we are very drawn towards it. And then with the 7 of Cups as well, this is about temptation, okay? Looking at our options and being tempted by other options. So, needless to say, I feel like it's going to be a very exciting month. I'm hearing the word juicy. So there might be juicy gossip, juicy details, juicy, you know, love affairs, juicy love advances, okay? And so I feel that it's going to be a very, it's not going to be boring. It's not going to be boring at all. So let me talk to you first about the imagery that came out when I was shuffling the cards. And the word that I heard was a feast, okay? And what I saw was, you know, it looks like it looks like a scene on a boat, like on a cruise ship, long ago, like probably in the early century, so like 1911, 1920, around that time period. You have this man; he's at a dinner table at a on a cruise or in a very extravagant restaurant, right? So he's got a suit on. A tuxedo, like a black and white tuxedo on. He's dressed really, really nicely. He's about 30 years old. And he sits down at a table with tablecloth. And the waiter, and I just cannot express how decadent the environment is. I mean, you know, it's got tablecloth. It's a fancy dining place. And the waiter comes in with the wine list and comes in with the special. And the waiter is just like, what would you be having today, sir? It seems as if the waiter has seen him there many, many, many times. So this is a man that, you know, has a lot of wealth. And he's able to afford dining at this really extravagant restaurant or venue on a regular basis. But I do see that he's there by himself. But he's able to be there. He's able to have the money and the resources in order to dine there. And the waiter's just like, what will you have today, sir? And the man says, I want everything. Okay, I want everything. And this is, so it happens that this is a seafood restaurant. That's what I feel. And so the waiter comes back a moment later, possibly like 15, 20 minutes later, once the food have been prepared. And he comes in with this platter. It's a huge platter. It's enough to feed a couple of people. But he brings it to the man's table. He opens up the little, the lid. And you see a lobster in the middle. Oysters on the side of it. Oysters on the side. And then there are, you know, a variety of dipping sauces. And there are also, different platters with different types of seafood prepared in different ways. Okay, so I feel like, you know, he's ordered a feast. He's ordered a lot of things. And he does it because he can. Because he has the wealth and he has, you know, the resources in order to do so. I don't see him eating it. The scene just cuts out. So, first of all, let me talk about this whole concept about a feast, okay? And I feel like it's really drawing my attention to a feast or famine type of an environment, okay? I feel like you're that man. You're that man in the nice clothing, the tuxedo, in this really beautiful, extravagant restaurant. And you told the waiter, you know, I want everything, okay? And I feel like there might have been a period of time in your life where you wanted everything, but you couldn't have everything. Maybe out of financial constraints, maybe out of a sheer sense of discipline, or maybe the opportunities were scarce, or maybe you were operating from a place where you were, you know, denying yourself of nice things, of extravagant things, because you thought it was frivolous, right? And so I feel this concept of feast or famine, you know, I see a lot of people who might be in the fitness industry where, you know, you have to present yourself a certain way, so you might have to go on binge dieting, heavily monitoring your water and your food intake. And so there might be bouts of time where you're binging a lot on certain foods to bulk up, and then there are times when you're, you know, required to drastically lose the weight or tone up or shape up in some way or some fashion. And so I feel like, you know, there were times where you had to eat, and then there were times where you had to slim down. And so I feel like it's work related for many of you. I also feel for many of you, you might have been working, literally working really, really, really hard. Okay, the things that you that were given to you, or I'm sorry, the things that were in your life were things that you had to work hard for, sweat and tears, you know, the whole concept of, things were not handed to you on a silver platter, and you had to go out into the world and hustle and scramble for all your resources. And I feel that, you know, things were in flux. On some days, the going is good and you might make a really good sell. And then on other days, it's a famine where it's a drought. There's just no customers, no sales. And so I feel that because of it, when you are in a good position, when you feel that you could have a lot of resources, when you have a lot of resources, you feel like, I deserve this. I'm going to splurge, I'm going to binge, I'm going to buy the things that I have been depriving myself during times of famine. And so that's what I'm sensing. So I feel like there's something here where things are heavily in flux, okay? And then I also feel, you know, the whole concept with seafood and oysters and things from the, from the realm of water, animals that dwell in the realm of water. I feel like this is definitely an emotional feast. For some reason, they want me to let that sink in with you or let that sit with you for just a moment, an emotional feast. Hence the whole concept with temptation and, you know, a draw, an emotional draw towards a specific thing, a specific person, someone who's very alluring, something that is from the realm of water, potentially, you know, out of our league, okay? So out of our league, like the leagues of the sea, It's a measurement unit. So the like some out of our league or somebody who's like traditionally not somebody that we think we would be able to attain, we would be able to have, and then all of a sudden they give us a lot of attention and we're just like, oh my gosh, you know. And then I'm also hearing as well, you know, with this emotional feast, I'm hearing as well, you know, like emotional eating and emotional binging, wanting to fulfill a deeper part of our emotional needs with food, with substance, with things, and an emotional void, an emotional need cannot be fulfilled with things, okay? And so that's for a very small minority, but I feel like the whole imagery is very decadent. It's very sensual, and it is also really tactile, okay? I'm drawn to the oyster, like the hardness of the shell is contrasted by the softness and you know, the softness and the sliminess of the inside, okay? It's something that is really hard on the surface, and it is very slimy in the center. I feel like you're dealing with someone like this, where they're very, very hard up. They put up a wall. They are very cold and possibly, you know, abrasive on the surface. But inside is this, you know, gooey, soft middle. So it indicates to me somebody who has a really soft heart. And I feel like the world has made them very hard. The world, life was hard for them. This could also be you, Libras. Okay, so I feel that, you know, you're very diplomatic. A lot of Libran people are just very diplomatic and you show a really nice face. But I do feel that you are skeptical. Okay, you're skeptical about, you know, about people's intentions, about life. And I feel like when you're dissatisfied with something, you voice your opinion, okay? You will get angry and you will be able to say, like, you know, exactly why that bothers you or why you're discontent. And so I feel like there might have been, you know, periods of famines where you're just, like, very discontent. And so we're coming into this, like, bubbling spring, the springtime of your life. And what I'm seeing as well is with this whole concept about, you know, that gushy center, feeling your heart soften all over again and being able to live your life more from that heart space rather than letting that abrasive, hard, I feel like, you know, gritty outside or exterior get to you, okay? So it's a very, very central type of a reading, and I'm going to talk about, you know, the cards individually. So first of all, moths to a flame. Okay, so I have here, this is the Five of Cups, and it's also the Firefly. Okay, so this is like a flicker of light, somebody sending out their intentions, making their intentions known, drawing attention to themselves, and especially, you know, winged animals, especially insect, they are messengers. They're all about being able to communicate, and I feel like there is an emotional message here that somebody is communicating to you, but I feel that they have that hard exterior about them. They might have been burned in the past. They might be a little bit shy. They might not know how you are responding to them. They might not know how you feel about them. They might be very hesitant about your ability. They might be very hesitant about how to initiate contact, okay? So it's not like a calling, like, you know, I can pick up the phone or I can text you or I can, you know, shoot you an email. It's not that simple. I feel that it's somebody who is at odds with their emotions and how they feel about you. And crowning this is the Hangman, which is waiting, a state of suspension, waiting waiting for information, waiting for a situation to turn around, waiting for some type of a breakthrough. so that we understand what we need to do. And with this praying mantis, once again, you know, female mantises, they when they copulate, they eat the heads of the male mantis, okay? And so, once again, the whole concept about eating, and also, I just feel like, you know, the imagery surrounding this is, there's an element of risk and danger and, you know, losing face, okay, literally losing your head, losing face, not wanting to reach out to somebody and have it on red, where the other person read the message, but they don't respond, not wanting to be embarrassed. So I just feel like you're dealing with someone who's not really sure about how you feel about them. And they are, as well, they might be very confused about their feelings. They might be feeling things, and all their emotions are very bunched up, and they don't really know where to begin, okay? It's like fumbling in the dark. That's what this Five of Cups feel like to me. There's not enough light. Even though the animal is casting light or drawing in light, but you're only seeing, like, you know, kind of like Morse code, like sparks of light. It comes and it goes. And it's not enough light to guide you, to show you the way. And then furthermore, we have the moon, which is all about confusion. It's all about this really nebulous sense of emotions, okay? Like emotions overwhelming us, feeling things in on a very, like, empathic, psychic level, including feeling things on a very deep emotional level, but we can't really make sense of it. Things are foggy, things are hazy. We're navigating an environment that can feel really uncomfortable because we can't really see what's, you know, 2 feet in front of us. And so I feel like there's a situation here where someone is feeling things so strongly about another person. It's a mixture of really complicated feelings, love, hate, I feel, you know, and inexplicable, like, wanting somebody, but at the same time, it's like, oh no, that's not, you know, my usual type, or that's not, you know, that person would never go for me, or even, it's like falling in love with someone who you would classify as an enigma. It's someone who is mysterious. It's somebody who is confusing. It's somebody who is confused about their feelings for you. And so there might be a mirroring energy where you're one day they're, like, very affectionate, and the next they withdraw. And you're kind of confused as to, you know, do they like me or do they not? Do they want to get together or do they not? And I feel like someone's feeling is very strong. It's overwhelming almost. It's overwhelming where, you know, the first thing you wake up, you think about this person. The last thought on your mind is of this person right before you go to bed. So it's borderline obsession. I don't feel, you have a lot of good cards here. And so I just don't feel like, it's a bad person for you. I don't feel like there's toxicity, you know, like just bad things. I just don't feel like an icky, yucky vibe from it. I just feel like something is very strong. It's very pure, but you're having trouble even verbalizing your feelings. You're having trouble making sense of it. And honestly, because of all the choices and the options and the whole concept of famine and I want it all, you might be in a situation where you want to, where you want multiple people. You might be dealing with multiple people. You might be dealing with somebody that you're married to, or, you know, you're in a solid committed relationship with, and then there's somebody else that is really drawing your attention and capturing your imagination, right? And then I also feel like you might be, you know, doing a lot of experimentation, like dating, finding out what works for you. And we're in this period where there are so many choices. Once again, Seven of Cups. And actually, there's a lobster here. And surrounding the lobster, not oysters, but snails. Okay, so I just feel like, you know, you're in a period where there are so many options, where there are so many choices, where there are so many possibilities. And look at those shells. They're so pretty, different colors. And you're kind of like this lobster, trying to, you know, look at your options, weigh out your options. And so I just feel like, you know, it's definitely, there's no famine here. This is a period of time where there are so many options in love and romance, where you're not going, you're, the real challenge is figuring out what works for you. And it, as well, you know, this is the shell depiction here, lots of choices, lots of option. And so you're in a period where you have a lot to choose from, and the temptation is really strong. You might have, you know, the affinity towards multiple people. We have here the choices, the Lover's card. This is a very strong sexual energy, okay? Like, it's a really strong physical connection with another person. It's like finding our counterpart, being able to, it's like feeling very, very strongly passionate, obsessed, even consumed with our emotions for another person, and it flows mutually. So I definitely don't think this is unrequited at all. I feel like it is very strong, and in some ways, I just feel like you're fighting yourself. You're fighting yourself about how you should react. Seven of Wands, okay, holding yourself back. And I also feel like, you know, your friends, your family members, the people who know you well might have, you know, their opinions about this connection, about this person. And they might be telling you, what are you doing? You know, excuse me. They might be telling you, like, what are you doing? Why are you with this person? This is not a good match. Or, you know, they have their opinions. Everyone has their opinions. You might be dating two people. And people are just like, what are you doing? Why are you doing this to two people? Or you might be dating multiple people and you're okay with it because this is a period of feast for you. You understand what it means to, you know, have gone through a period of famine and now you're in it. You just want to indulge. You want to get your hands dirty. You want to embrace life. You want to take up these opportunities because, you know, you understand that it doesn't come every day. This is not, you know, any time of the year, any time of the day. This is something very special. And so I feel like, you know, if people are judging or if people are giving you, you know, advice and you've never asked for it, it's like unsolicited advice, you're not going to give them the time of day. And so there is a partner here. It's they're bringing about, you know, like a major overhaul in your life. I have the Awakening card. This is the Judgment card. Contact, communication. This is, once again, very decadent. The Peacock, okay? With this Judgment card, contact and communication, I just feel like this person is bringing about a sense of awareness that has been very dormant within you. You might have also gone a really long time without dating. And then all of a sudden, all of these people are throwing themselves at you. And you're wondering, you're kind of like, I feel, what is that word that's coming through? It's awakening your passion for the very first time. Somebody is awakening a part of you that has lain dormant for so long. And you began to doubt that that the passion could even be awoken again. And a lot of the times, you know, if we've been through like a really bad relationship where we got our heart shattered to a million pieces, we find it really difficult to trust in another person, to believe in love, and to go out there and find a kindred soul. But somebody is coming into the picture and they really meet all your requirements, and I also feel like they're awakening that dormant passion within you, and it feels really good, right? Like, this is a really feel-good, decadent feast that's happening in front of you. I guess the advice here, of course, with all this passion And all this energy is for us to take things slow, okay? Don't lose our sight. See things in black and white. So what this means is a lot of the times when we're in a relationship, we feel that the other person that we're in love with, they can do no wrong. We overlook a lot of bad traits, a lot of bad things that surface at the from the get-go because we're, you know, it's puppy love. We're infatuated. And and I feel like, you know, we're willing to overlook a lot of things. So this is kind of like telling you to kind of ground yourself, keep things in perspective. And, you know, if they have faults, just make a mental note of it, okay? Don't get so wrapped up in the other person where you believe they can do no wrong. We're all humans, right? If you're thinking, it's not real. You're thinking like, this is too good to be true. It's not real. And I also feel that you're doubting the connection. You're just like, it's happening too fast for so long. I've been in this drought, in this famine, and in this state of like parched earth, like scorched earth, where I didn't feel anything, where there was not enough abundance. And then all of a sudden it happens and you doubt it. You doubt the connection. And there's a part of you that, you know, is very rational, where you overanalyze a situation and the way that it makes you feel and the way you respond to this person, it just doesn't make sense. And because it doesn't make sense, you don't trust it. And so I feel that you should let go of these things that are really holding you back and look at this situation for what it is, all the synchronicities, all the series of events that have to kind of like play out in order for the two of you to be able to meet. And we have as well the moon. Furthermore, confusion. Okay, options, confusion. And I can assure you, this is a very good connection. You definitely should explore it. You definitely should take your time to get the other to know the other person. And you want to do it with, you know, eyes wide open, so that you're not you're not like blinded by the infatuation. But then I also feel for many of you, you're in a really bad relationship. You've met somebody new that's like a breath of fresh air. And it's making you question and re-examine whether or not the current relationship is still good for you. Okay, it's still good for you. So that's for those who are in like an unhappy attachment, a relationship, a marriage, or whatever it is. You're questioning its viability in your future. So enjoy this moment, whatever it is, whatever this feast is for you. I just feel, you know, let's say this. Man's eating a lobster at a really fancy, you know, venue, and he's wearing a suit, right? And when you eat seafood, your hands are going to get dirty. You have to use those things to break the claws. You have to, you know, there's a lot of gunk inside seafood, right? Not in a bad way, but there's a lot of like little tidbits, juice and things like that. So it's not like a sandwich. It's not like something that's easy to eat. You're going to get, you know, guts and juice flowing all over. And so I feel like he's saying, I want everything. He really wants to experience that tactile sensation. He really wants to get his hands dirty. He's willing to put in the work. He's willing to, you know, it's not like he's on the sidelines nibbling at life. He wants the whole damn thing. And he's willing to get his hands dirty and going like straight for it, for whatever it is that you want. Which is great. I'm glad to see this. So I will leave it at that, Libras. I wish you the very, very best for this month. It looks amazing.